Let's start with the discussion of the first disorder of the cornea, that is keratoconus. Now, what is actually the meaning of keratoconus? Keratoconus per se means that it is a bilateral non-inflammatory ectatic condition of cornea. Now, what it means, let's say our cornea is like this, okay? This is the structure of cornea. If without any inflammation, it becomes like this. So this is a conical cornea. So this is called keratoconus, okay? So how would the patient present? They would basically ask you a question where a 26-year-old guy came to the OPD and he says that, sir, I am having high refractive error and there is a cylinder as well. So the young male came to the OPD and says that there is a blurring of vision. Even with spectacle, there is a high myopia with astigmatism. So all this basically points towards the diagnosis of the keratoconus. So first of all, what are the various signs which you can see in cornea, which basically tell you that this patient may be suffering from keratoconus? So first of all, the sign, the most important one is Munson sign. What happened in a Munson sign is when we look downward, okay, when we look downward, there is a basically bowing of the lower lid. So lower lid bows like this, okay? So this is bowing or bulging of lower lid on down gaze. This is called the Munson sign. What are the other signs? Normally the corneal nerves are not seen in a cornea, but when there is a thinning of the cornea in a keratoconus, these nerves can be seen. So this is the differential diagnosis of enlarged corneal nerves. So they not may not be the enlarged, but they are more prominent. Then on retinoscopy, we would have a reflex which is called oil droplet reflex. Now, as there is a cone, okay, so the reflex of the top of the cone would be seen when we are doing a retinoscopy, like a oil droplet, okay? So something, when we do a retinoscopy, we see a orange glow. Because of the cone, you would see that something like a oil globule is there in the sea of the fundus, okay? So this is called a oil droplet reflex. Let's move to the other sign, which is called Rizzuti sign. Now, what is the meaning of Rizzuti sign? Normally, when we put a torch in the temporal side of the eye, it basically illuminates less than half of the nasal side of the iris. Okay, so normally we have less than half of the nasal side of the iris which is illuminated in a normal person, because when there is a keratoconus, there is a deep anterior chamber. So in that cases, more than half of this iris would be visible on the temporal view from the light or a torch source. Okay. So what is the Rizzuti sign? I basically write it here as a more than half of the nasal iris would be seen when torch is shown from temporal side. Okay, this is an important sign to remember. Then, because of the thinning of the cornea, there may be some breaks in the Desmond membrane through which the aqueous can go into the stroma. Okay, and this is called a phenomenon of hydrops. So hydrops is basically breaks in Desmond membrane, which is basically causing aggregation of aqueous in the inner layers. Okay, then the next reflex is called a scissor reflex. Now, what is the meaning of scissor reflex? During a retinoscopy, when we have a myopic person and we basically put the direct retinoscope and see from a patient, the fundus reflex is there and it would go like this. Okay, so this is against the reflex. So during a direct retinoscopy, if the patient is a myopic and the myopia is more than the distance correction, we would basically study this when we would study retinoscopy. But either the motion is like this or in the same direction. But when we are a patient of a keratoconus in front of us and there is a astigmatism and irregular astigmatism, the movement would be something like this, like a scissor. Okay, so this is called a scissor reflex in keratoconus. Then we have, as I told you, thinning of the cornea, and this thinning is more in the central and paracentral region. And because of this, there may be some iron deposition at the base of cones, which is basically called Fleischer ring. Do not confuse it with the KF ring. Remember, KF ring is copper and Fleischer ring is the iron deposition ring. Last but not the least, we can have stria in the cornea, which are more vertical in orientation, which are called Vogt stria. Do not confuse it with the Hab stria, which is seen in the patients of congenital glaucoma. Okay, let's move to what are the keratometry findings in the patient of keratoconus. Keratometry means the corneal curvature. As I told you, the normal refractive power of cornea is around 43 diopter. But because of the increased curvature, this would basically also increase. So here, the corneal curvature is more steep. So it is more than 47 diopter. Sometimes it can go to up to 55 to 60 diopter. Okay, and the pattern which we see on a corneal topography would be like this. Okay, so this is called a bow tie pattern, or I would say more of a asymmetrical bow tie pattern. And a keratometry also tells us about the corneal thickness, and as I told you that there is a decreased in the central corneal thickness. So I write it here as CCT, decrease in the central corneal thickness. So these are the findings which we can basically see in the keratometry. This keratometry is basically done with a Placido disc keratoscope, ob scan. But what you have to remember now is the investigation of choice, that is PentaCam. So remember, a PentaCam is the investigation of choice in a patient of keratoconus or any corneal ectatic disorder, because it can tell us about the both surfaces of the cornea, the curvature of the cornea, so both anterior and posterior curvature of the cornea. It can tell us about the anterior chamber depth. It can tell us about the corneal thickness at various levels, and it can basically tell us whether it is a normal patient or an abnormal patient. Okay, so it can tell us the probability of this patient to have keratoconus. So remember, the PentaCam is the investigation of choice. Now we come to the how we classify keratoconus. So keratoconus can be classified as a mild, moderate, or severe keratoconus. You do not have to go into too much of the details of the keratoconus. Just remember the names of the classification, that is called a Kisa index, और रेबिनोविट्स क्राइटेरिया. जस्ट रिमेंबर द नेम, डू नॉट नीड टू गो इनटू टू मच ऑफ डिटेल्स और व्हाट इज द कीसा इंडेक्स और रेबिनोविट्स क्राइटेरिया. ओके, सो नाउ लेट्स गो टू द वेरियस एसोसिएशंस. द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट एसोसिएशन ऑफ केराटोकोनस इज द पेशेंट हु इज ऑल्सो सफरिंग फ्रॉम वर्नल केराटोकंजंक्टिवाइटिस. यू वुड हैव अ पेशेंट, अ क्वेश्चन वेयर अ पेशेंट इज बेसिकली रबिंग द आई, अ 10-year-old चाइल्ड एंड हैविंग अ रोपी डिस्चार्ज. दे वुड आस्क यू विच कॉर्नियल डिसऑर्डर दिस पेशेंट इज मोर प्रीडिस्पोज टू. सो रिमेंबर, वर्नल केराटोकंजंक्टिवाइटिस, दीज पेशेंट्स आर मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंटली एसोसिएटेड. ओके, वॉट आर द अदर डिसऑर्डर्स? एनी डिसऑर्डर ऑफ कोलेजन कैन बी basically a association with keratoconus. So like Marfan syndrome, patient of mitral valve prolapse, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, okay, and even in congenital cataract we have seen the association. So if you ask me, sir, which is the one which we have to remember, it is vernal keratoconjunctivitis and Marfan's. These are the most important ones. Now let's move to what is the treatment modality of the patients of keratoconus. So first of all, we start with the simple refraction. We give power of glasses to the child. But the problem is that when the cornea is like this, a lens like this would not basically suffice. So normally in the patients of advanced keratoconus, these patients are not very comfortable with the glasses. So what we can do here is we can put a contact lens like a shape of cornea in this patient so that it adjusts there. So the best treatment, or the better treatment I would say, in these patients is that we give good rigid gas permeable contact lens to the patient, which can be fitted like a corneal shape. And now we have better lenses which are called Rose-K lenses, which are customized according to the curvature of the cornea. Okay, then if the patient is having advanced keratoconus which is progressing as well, so earlier the corneal thickness is 45 diopter, now it has improved to, or it has basically increased to 47 or 50 diopter. So in these cases of progressive keratoconus, we have to basically act faster and halt the progression. So to halt the progression, we do a treatment with the help of riboflavin vitamin, which I call collagen cross-linking. So what I do in collagen cross-linking, I remove the epithelium of the cornea, and after removing the epithelium of the cornea, I put the riboflavin over the cornea and then irradiate it with the UV radiation. Okay, so I put, remove the epithelium, put riboflavin, and then put UVA radiation. That would basically make covalent bonds between the various collagen fibers. So this is a phenomenon of collagen cross-linking. We do it in the patients who have progressive keratoconus. Now the problem is, let's say the patient is having a progressive keratoconus and a high refractive error, and we want to correct the both. So in that case, what we can do is we can do a procedure like this, which you can see here is there is a ring which we have put inside the stroma. And this ring which we have put inside the stroma, this is called intracorneal ring segment. It strengthens the stromal part as well as it basically corrects the refractive error as well. So strengthen the cornea, this is called a intracorneal ring segment. Let's say patient is still progressing and the patient has got opacity in the stromal part. Now if this opacity is there in the anterior stroma, what we can do is we can just remove that part of the stroma, okay, and we can put a new cornea over that, okay. And this procedure where the anterior stroma, the anterior half of the stroma is removed and a new cornea is put over that, this is called a anterior lamellar keratoplasty. I call it anterior lamellar keratoplasty. But if this scarring is up to the middle or deep of the stroma, then we have to remove more than half of the stroma as well, and that is called DALK, that is the deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. Last but not the least is a condition where the scarring is throughout the cornea or going up to the Desmond's membrane. In that case, we do not have the option. We have to remove whole of the cornea. Okay, we remove whole of the cornea and basically put a new cornea, a new transparent cornea over that. So this total keratoplasty is called penetrating keratoplasty. So we revise it once again. If the patient is having a scarring which is superficial, we can do only anterior lamellar keratoplasty, which we call ALTK. If it is more deep in the stroma, we can remove the epithelium, the Bowman's membrane, and up to the deep stroma. We call it DALK, that is the deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. If the scarring is up to the Desmond membrane, then we have no option. We have to remove the whole of the cornea. That is called full thickness corneal transplant or a penetrating keratoplasty. So these are some important points which you should remember regarding the keratoconus, one of the most important topic in the corneal disorders.